outside, you have all heard about the Institute of Science. You've all heard about the wonderful work that we're doing. And I'm quite confident that this country and the globe as such is going to be very much benefited by many of you who are studying here. So allow me to say that I'm very delighted to be here. I'm also delighted to be here addressing Prasthutha, because I've heard of this organization. I've heard of your efforts at promoting a certain vision of this country. Now, that is precisely the beginning of my talk, because when we define national security, now it's like, for example, national terrorism, international terrorism. In the internet world today, in the world of aviation, there is no longer something called national security or international security. Something that takes place in Raqqa, in Syria, something that takes place in Germany can affect India and vice versa. So the entire distinction between domestic and international has, in a sense, broken down. And then we ask ourselves, what does this do to the entire concept of nationalism? What exactly, you know, how do we define nationalism in an era where we are actually cutting across boundaries and where human progress mandates, for example, the rubbing away of boundaries in terms of effective transmission? Now, wherever you've got organizations, you've got groups of nations that respect boundaries in a very large way, for example, the European Union. The European Union, according to their own rules, somebody from Romania who has been in the mafia is more welcome in Britain than a postgraduate of the Indian Institute of Science, because that person is from Romania and you are from Bangalore in India. This really doesn't make sense, because you would be doing much more good to that economy, to that society, than the other gentleman would. But because you have this kind of a clear a question of boundaries, there are these kind of gaps that have been put up, and this is one of the factors, in fact, I'd like to say, that one thing which I'd like to bring to your attention is, how exactly are we going to define nationalism and make this nationalism such that, in a sense, we carry this nationalism with us wherever we go, and we don't carry it in a hostile way when we go outside. But we carry it in an osmotic way, we carry it in a way in which that kind of, the energy that comes from that nationalism is developed wherever we go. Because it is a reality that you have seen people from India who go to different countries in the world, you have seen people from different countries in the world coming to India, and how the synergy, the energy they bring is very, very large. On the other hand, you have individuals who are technically being in this country all their lives, and some of them are not very helpful to the country at all. So the whole definition of nationalism, and whether we need to go beyond the geographic definition, whether we need to go beyond the, if I may say so, that kind of definition is something to be talked about. In terms of, now, why I want to say this is that we are having this huge debate in this country on campuses, etc., on, I mean, we talk in terms of left and right. I had a very interesting discussion with my friend here in Europe when he was bringing me from the hotel to this location about left and right. And it's very ironic that today the left is coming out as a votary of individual freedoms. Now, I'm not very certain that those countries where the left is very strong, whether it is Cuba, whether it is China, or whether it is India, Vietnam, these are countries where there are a great deal of individual freedom. I'm not so sure about that. But somehow in India, the left is being associated with more freedoms. And possibly the reason for that is the right, to some extent, now that it has come to power after the 16th of May, 2014, the right to some extent is now embracing the colonial construct of the state. Now, I'll tell you how. For example, in the case of Jawaharlal Nehru University, the discussion that took place there was completely faulty, it was wrong. But involving the police in that, involving state agencies in that, creates an entirely new dynamic, which in my view goes against the fundamental principles of the so-called right. It's the same thing regarding, for example, alcohol. It's the same thing regarding dress, the same thing regarding diet. In all these matters, I mean, the vegetarian diet, for example, makes a lot of sense from the point of view of ecology. It is supposed to make a lot of sense from the point of view of human biology, from the point of view of human health. But the question is this going to be imposed through law, or is it going to be imposed through, if I may say so, the willing consent of people? And it is very important for organizations that are nationalists not to shirk their responsibility of going among the people, conscientizing them, raising their level of understanding of these issues, rather than relying on the short fix, the quick fix of government action. Now, if you talk in terms of one process of conscientization, that is one thing. If you talk in terms of giving a law which bars an activity, it's quite another. And usually, my experience is, because it's a colonial system, because the laws are very colonial, the people in this country have very little regard and respect for them. And they don't voluntarily support the law, they don't voluntarily abide by the law. They abide by the law out of fear, out of circumstance, but they don't feel an obligation that as a good citizen you need to follow the law. And the reason for that may be that we have so many laws in this country that is beyond counting. Now, I have long said, for example, that you can send a person to jail in India much easier than you can send a person to jail in most countries in Asia, except North Korea. You get a complaint filed against somebody, you get a friendly policeman, you get a very friendly television anchor to put your face on television and paint you as one of the worst human beings on earth. And I can assure you, the police wagon is going to come at your door very soon. And there is zero protection in law for that, because our laws are so flexible, under almost any situation you can be sent in. Now, this is something the right must say is not acceptable. As someone who is a nationalist, someone who is a right winger, the people of this country are not children anymore. The British treated them as children. The Nehruvian system treated them as children. They will not be treated as children anymore. And it is that, if I may say so, assertion of adulthood, for example, which led to the victory of the BJP. And therefore, we expect much faster progress of the BJP towards ensuring that this colonial concepts of law end, and that the ability of the state to deprive a citizen of his or her property, of his or her freedoms, of his or her rights, liberty, that ability should be significantly reduced under law. Now, in India, it's a much easier thing than it is in many other countries. I mean, we had as a family friend an individual named P.V. Narasimha Rao, Pamela Party Venkata Narasimha Rao, whom I honestly believe is one of the great prime ministers of this country. As industry minister, more than Manmohan Singh, it is Narasimha Rao who introduced this whole concept of liberalization. Because he liberalized the license system, he allowed a lot more freedom to industrial units, whereas what Manmohan Singh did was basically make it easier for foreign goods to come to India. Manmohan Singh was always been a very difficult customer in terms of reducing taxes on Indian taxpayers and reducing taxes on Indian companies, but he was extremely good at reducing taxes on foreign companies and reducing taxes on foreign entities to come to India. I'm sorry to say that that kind of economics, in which liberalization basically means liberalization for the foreigner but continued servitude for the Indian, is still largely seen in a lot of our economic and fiscal policies today. And this is something which I would expect this current government to alter very fundamentally. For the reality of the situation is, the reason why this government came here, the reason is change with a capital C. It is not adjustment, it's not accommodation, it is change with a capital C. So I want to talk to you as friends and say that, I'm not going to use the terms right or left, I'm certainly going to use the term nationalist, because I do believe that pride in a country is extremely important. I do believe that pride in a family is extremely important. And one reason why we do exceptionally well in the United States is that the people of Indian origin largely have great pride in their family. They have great pride in their culture. I mean, you know, they have immense pride, which is not shared. That degree of pride may not be shared by all groups, and which is why the Indian-American group does exceptionally well. The point is that it is very important, therefore, one, for the right wing to avoid recourse to the state, and to avoid calling on the state, especially the police, for any kind of intervention in almost all these matters. The reason is very simple. Long back, you had a gentleman called Richard Nixon. You had a gentleman called Bill Clinton. Now, what these two gentlemen did is, they criminalized a whole range of activity in the United States so far as narcotics is concerned. Any kind of narcotics, any of the most mildest form of narcotics, barring alcohol and tobacco, which they could not criminalize because it would lead to a revolution and a revolt in the United States if you did that. But barring alcohol and tobacco, they criminalized almost every aspect of narcotics. Now, narcotics is an evil. I mean, I'd like to say, I have never had, frankly, recourse to narcotics. It is definitely an evil, just as I have, except once or twice in Paris, for example, I got a ham sandwich, but I didn't know French. So I asked for a cheese sandwich and I got a ham sandwich. And I must confess, I took 2.5 bites. And my wife then told me it was a ham sandwich. I stopped eating it, but I would like to confess here that it was not entirely an untasty sandwich. So, if my wife had not spoken to me, it's quite likely that particular cheese, I would have taken the entire sandwich. But what I'm trying to tell you is, we have to understand that problem areas, the main problem areas, the core areas, in terms of drugs, is not these soft drugs that's a problem. For example, legalization of marijuana has taken place in a large number of states in the United States. I don't think that law and order has become much worse in those areas, far from it. If you look at the statistics, it's become far better. Because then the state can concentrate on the real hard drugs, on heroin, on cocaine, on these hard drugs. In India, you can send a pickpocket to jail for allegedly stealing 5 rupees. But it's very, very difficult to send a tycoon to jail. I mean, tell me how many tycoons are in jail today, and you can count them on this one hand of mine. I'm quite certain. Now, I'm quite certain we have more tycoons than 5 in this country. And we have more tycoons than 5 in this country who have committed a lot of illegalities. But tell me the number of tycoons in jail, tell me the number of pickpockets and small-scale burglars in jail, and I'll tell you exactly the system that is going after the wrong people. This is what I would like to say. If you have a minimal kind of activity, like for example stealing something, there are ways beyond prison to do that. Because again in the colonial system, now I want to say all this because all this has a bearing on national security. The fabric of a state, the fabric of a society of a state has to be strong and just. It has to be based on solid principles for national security overall to be in a state of health. And that's why I'm saying, for example, that people who are guilty of these kind of activities, in the majority of cases, sending them to jail is a waste of money. They need to have some kind of other treatment, like for example, work in a field or work in somewhere else. And the really hardcore people who are doing immense damage to the country, these are the gentlemen and ladies who should fill our jails. For example, punishment should rise, I'm not going to say in geometric progression, because you guys are mathematicians, you know what that is, but certainly punishment should rise the higher the level of the official. And certainly it should be a very high level for ministers and for legislators and for others who are holding positions of responsibility and authority in which they are sworn on oath to defend the people and defend the state. Instead of which, what do we see? You see small fry who have not signed any oath of office, who have not been powerful any day of their lives. These are the gentlemen and ladies who are today largely in our prison system. And a prison system, may I add, in which you lose access to internet, you lose access to mobile phones, you lose access to books, but within 6 months, you are no longer useful in society. If you spend 2-3 years in that kind of confinement, without access to mobile phones, without access to the internet, with access to a lot of people who frankly become, you know, have developed a lot of mental worries and mental psychoses because of their confinement and because of other circumstances. In I would say 6 months to 2 years to 3 years or certainly, when you come out of society, you become absolutely useless. Now, why I'm saying this is that there are a large number of educational institutions in India where they train individuals in a manner which frankly make it very difficult for those individuals to do gainful employment. Among the things they teach in these institutions is that life begins at the grave. Now, this is not something that is taught by the fanatics of for example, of these institutions. It is taught by the most moderate elements that your life really begins at the grave. Now, if you instill that feeling that your life begins when you are killed, obviously you are going to have a predisposition that if I am a suicide bomber, I can reach the grave much quicker and I want to live life. Who doesn't? You know, everybody would like to live life. So if my life begins at the grave, I'd certainly like to be a suicide bomber that much quicker. So these institutions are flourishing in this country, if I may say so. They're doing extremely well. There have been some effort to make sure the graduates of these institutions are put on par with graduates of, for example, the Indian Institute of Science. It has happened in Pakistan, it has not yet happened in India, but that pressure is going to be continuous. The reality of the situation is, it's a grave national security threat. But this threat cannot be, sorry.
Sir, I have a question. Can you please clarify what is state, what is the nation, and what is nationalism of the state?
Well, the way I am defining in my discussion is, the state is the government. Is the government. The nation is the government and the people. That is the definition. The state is the government, which is the apparatus of state power, which is the government. That's what I'm defining the state as. I'm not talking of civil society, I'm not talking of civil organization, I'm talking of the government. That is the way it is. So, you know, as I said, now going back to this, this kind of thing that I was talking about, this is the kind of teaching that is now taking place everywhere. Now, if we position this in terms of religion, I'll give you a simple example. As I said, I mean, it's been said in that thing that I had a lot of discussions about Israel, for example, and I would like to say clearly, I have great regard for the Jewish people. I regard the Jewish people as a community as having done more for humanity per capita than any other people on earth. Whether Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, any other people on earth, I think the Jewish people per capita have done more in terms of innovation, in terms of invention, in terms of cultural treasure than any other people on earth. But the state of Israel may have made mistake after mistake. And those who support the Jewish people may also have made mistake. And one of the mistakes they made, which I pointed out several times, is this whole concept of Iran as a terror state. Now, I've been to Iran multiple times. I've given lectures in Iran, Shahid Bahesht University during the time Mahmoud Ahmadinejad was president of Iran, on the need for secularism. And if you say, for example, the mullahs are enemies of the people, if you say, for example, the Khomeinists are enemies of the people, that's fine, because you may be right. The mullahs are a problem, some of them are not, but many of them are. The Khomeinists are a problem. In fact, if you look at my writings, if you analyze them, you find I have equated Khomeinism with Wahhabism. Despite one being so-called Shia, so-called Sunni, both have got a lot of common characteristics. But and if you say that, look, Khomeinists are, you know, are terrorists, but if you say Iran is terrorist, everybody in Iran will then feel this refers to me. He or she won't like it. And he or she will stop looking at your argument. So the day you say a particular community is extremist or whatever it is, you are basically ensuring that that community is not any longer going to listen to your argument. Whereas it's extremely important that that community listen to your argument. Now, I have heard some people criticize the Prime Minister, for example, for making very, very, you know, if I may say so, non-entity references to the Muslim community. Now, I'd like to say very clearly that, I mean, I'm not a scholar of this at all, but there are 113 verses in the Quran, And 112 of these verses begin with the words mercy and compassion. There's an entire surah in the Quran, which I think Surah Rahmani, which talks about mercy and compassion. Now, you have in the Quran itself, you have the Meccan verses and you have the Medinian verses. The Meccan verses are very different from the Medinian verses because they're in the time of war. Now, if you argue that the Medinian verses basically were in the time of war, and in a wartime situation they apply, but otherwise in a normal situation the verses of Makkah apply, there is an argument that we can take forward to ensure that this cancer of Wahhabism that is spreading across the globe since the 1970s is to some extent rolled back. Let me tell you, it's spreading in India also in an extremely rapid way. The last 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, forget 30 years, the last 15 years I would say, it has spread very rapidly. Now it has spread because somehow the arguments we use are not being absorbed by those who need to absorb them and who need to understand that we are not talking against somebody. So when we do, in this I would like to say, I mean, if I want to use a marketing term, I know it's sacrilege to use a marketing term in terms of Indian culture, but may I say that India needs to market its culture a little better. You use a marketing term, you've got a wonderful soap called Chandrika. It's the best soap in the world. Hardly anybody uses it because the marketing is terrible. The packaging is terrible. Now, we have a message of nationalism, we would like Chandrika soap. It's a beautiful message. It's a powerful message. It's a universal message. But I'm sorry to say, the way we dress up that message, the way we communicate that message, leaves a lot to be desired, with the result that most people don't absorb that particular message. So, I'm saying frankly, that when we're talking in terms of this leftist and that leftist, this guy, that guy, for heaven's sake, please understand, it's our failure as well. It's our failure not to be able to tell them that of what we are doing. Because all we are telling them is, this is a country with roots of at least 5, if not 10,000 years of civilization. This is a country where we have been battered by, for example, the British. And the battering has taken place because we have been told our history is myth. Anything that is noble in our history is myth. But I would like to ask you, even today, we had for 6 years of Mr. Vajpayee. Even today, why is it that I see a hesitation in saying that Lord Rama, for example, actually existed? Because if we say that, we are giving an option to people to respect Lord Rama, at the same time, not say that he is divine, but say that he was one of the greats of history. He was like Alexander, he was like Julius Caesar, he was like, much more, of course, than Ashoka. So, if I want to accept Lord Rama as a great king, I should be given the freedom to do so. It's not that I have to accept Lord Rama means I have to worship him, I have to do this kind of ritual to him, otherwise I am not accepting Lord Rama. But I have to accept Lord Rama as a king, because only by accepting Lord Rama as a king can we go ahead and introduce, for example, a path from Ayodhya to Lanka. I am surprised that today, even today, we do not have the tracing of the path of Lord Rama from Ayodhya to Lanka. In my view, tens of millions of people across the globe, I am not just talking of people who are born Hindus, I am talking of people who are born from different religions, Muslims, Christians, Jewish people, all of them would love to retrace those steps. And as you retrace those steps, as you go into some of the locations where he rested, where Hanuman rested, where Sita rested, you will, I think, your flesh will stand up. Goosebumps will come on you and you will feel immensely proud of belonging to the same country where Lord Ram, Sita lived. You will feel immensely proud of it. But if you take Lord Ram as divine, what are you saying? Again, I'm saying, I'm treading on slightly sensitive ground here. I want to say very clearly, I am a proud follower of Sanatana Dharma and I have no hesitation of that. I mean, my mother converted to Islam and my mother was very clear, she should be buried, she should not be cremated. We buried her. But as the eldest son, every single acharam, every single ritual that needed to be done for a departed mother to ensure that her soul got salvation, I did as the eldest son. And I'd like to say I was delighted to do it. I was very happy to do it. And I felt a strong sense of joy that I was able to fulfill what I regarded as a duty to my mother by fulfilling all these. My wife helped me. We went to several temples. We went to riversides. We went to all those locations where these need to be done. And we did it. So I just want to say that but I have a very liberal view of society and about things. If you notice the Sunday Guardian, for example, I am very clear that if you have, for example, a different kind of sexuality, it's not the law that should come into play, it's your conscience. It's something else. It's your society. It's your family, this thing. It should not be the law. Alcohol. I travel to Saudi Arabia. Let me assure you that if you take a flight out of Saudi Arabia, all these Saudi ladies that are covered up, the minute they're on that flight, and as soon as it crosses Saudi airspace into some walk, on the way to Europe, it's gone. And then you have minis, micro minis, midis, and all kinds of wonderful dresses, quite frankly. All kinds of lovely dresses. And these are different people altogether. And of course, you have got that huge 40-kilometer bridge from Dammam to Bahrain. And many people go there. Not because they're particularly fond of the Sultan of Bahrain, because they tank up there. Alcohol is available in Bahrain, so they tank up in Bahrain, they smuggle alcohol, they come here, they pay the border guards, and they keep their week supply or month supply. Look, you can't change human nature by law, by human law. And this is exactly what, for example, I tell my friends in the Muslim community. And I say, look, God's will is one thing, God's book is one thing, but human beings are another. Don't follow the teachings of human beings, because that is different from the teachings of God. So the same thing about the Medinan verses, the Meccan verses, the same thing about the fundamental truth of the Quran, of 112 chapters or 113 being about mercy and compassion. Now this is something which Wahhabis or Khomeinists have completely tossed aside. If you look at the religious books that are being taught today, their books are being taught in a way to hate the other side. It is basically being taught that it's your fundamental duty to establish your domination in any society that you are in. Establish your domination anyway, and that this is the will. This is the divine will. Now, if you are a person who is a believer, obviously, you will believe that it's the divine will, I should do it. But these books are plain wrong. And they do not reflect the spirit of the Quran, just as the fanaticism of the Khomeinis does not reflect the spirit of the people of Iran. Which is why I am saying, in the phraseology that many of us use, in the words we use, in the terms we use, in the arguments we use, we have to understand that unless you can convince certain core audiences of the validity of our claims, and I would like to say, these claims are essential for a stable country. We are not going to have a stable country. Unless the medication, so to speak, is in a form which is palatable, the patient is not going to recover. And by patient, I mean the entire country. Because today, let's face it, I used to write in the 1980s about superpower India. In the 1990s, I was optimistic about superpower India. I am very worried now about India going to territory of Pakistan. I'm no longer writing about superpower India. I'm no longer writing about this country becoming whatever. I'm seriously worried about some of the fault lines that I'm seeing in this country. And of course, I can track it. I can trace it. I can trace it, for example, to 1947, and a country that I've visited very often, 1949, China. That's not a country that's friendly to India. Absolutely not. But in 1949, the Chinese Communist Party took over a whole lot of territory which was never really Chinese. Xinjiang, Tibet, Inner Mongolia, a lot of other territories. In our country, what did we do? The British had Myanmar, they had Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Maldives, all these were broken away, and we had a truncated country. And even themselves outside, they contacted people, they made money, they they were pirates, and they gave that a little bit back to the queen, and they were not called pirates when they came back. They were called knights, and they were ennobled. The reason was the freedom. Why is it, for example, that you had a situation in which the army of Alexander was able to defeat the army of the Persian king? Because the army of Alexander was led by, comprised of Greeks who regarded themselves as a free people. Whether they were free or not is a different point. But each Greek was thought, you're a free person, you have certain rights, and you are in a sense equal to Alexander. And if I may say so, some of the songs they sang about Alexander loudly in the parade ground were not very complimentary songs. They sang songs about Alexander which would make him fall foul of a certain section of the Indian penal code, for example. They were not very complimentary songs, but they were allowed to sing those songs. It was a free army of free people fighting against a slave army of the Persian Empire. So the slaves said, why should we fight? If tomorrow we are the slaves of Xerxes, we are the slaves of Darius, we are the slaves of Cyrus, we are the slaves of Alexander. It makes no difference. We will still be slaves. So when we go back into the past, my point is again very simple. We are talking about nationalism. Let us analyze those attributes of successful societies, those attributes of the winners and those disattributes of the losers. Let us get those lessons from them and let us understand how, like a magnet, to raise those attributes within our own people. Now, I'll give you another example which confused me for a long time, which is, how was Prithviraj Chauhan, for example, defeated so badly by Guri? How did it happen? Because they had here a bigger army, much more developed, everything was much better. This guy was basically a gang of thugs, like the Taliban today. Mr. Muhammad Guri was basically that version of the Taliban. How on earth did this happen? How on earth was he defeated? The answer comes in two or three things. One, he was defeated and he was allowed to go back. Now, the point of the matter is that in a society, whether it's the British, whether it's the European, whether it's the Germans, when you are down, they make it very certain you are not going to fight them a second time. By one means or the other, you're not allowed to fight a second time. You are certainly not sent back with honor and respect. Okay, I've defeated you. Now, I respect you as a good fighter. You can go back. Okay. In that 1 year, what happened? Very little. He moved around the kingdom, did not organize himself. The other chap organized himself. He came back. He understood the weak points, elephants versus horses. He attacked early in the morning, if I'm not mistaken, about 1:40 or something in the morning, or 2 o'clock, when all the soldiers were asleep. And then they had to be roused from their sleep, and they had to face the attack. His soldiers were rested, because they rested in the evening. There are many ways in which he won that attack. And it's very important for us in Indian history to understand that ways. It's very important for all of us to learn those ways. But we don't understand those ways through our history. It's either it is the colonial kind of history, in which everything is a myth, you have nothing to be proud of, or it's an alternative history, in which everything is just so super. Everything is just so magnificent. We have all the people who are tremendous heroes, they are wonderful, the whole society was wonderful, it is so terrific. But then the question asks, if it is so terrific, why did we lose? Why did we lose our liberty? Why did we lose our freedom? Why did we lose our economic prosperity? Why did we lose our social cohesion? So if the two don't mesh, they don't mesh together. So what I'm trying to tell you this night here, you must pardon me for this thing, because I've stood up for a lot of things which fortunately the nationalist community has not misunderstood. Whenever I speak something, you may have individuals who misunderstand, but overall I'm happy to say I had the broad support nationalist community, and I'm grateful to this community, because there was a long period of time that there was a certain lady who was controlling the situation in this country very comprehensively. During that entire period of time, I could not write for any of the so-called mainstream media. I simply could not write for them, because any editor who carried my stuff would not be, would have some problems or quite a... The only two papers that allowed me to write were Organizer, which is run by the RSS, and Radiance, which is run by Jamaat Islam. So I am the one person who has written quite a lot, much more of course an organizer than Vedin, because the subjects I touch more, an organizer much more. But I wrote in these two papers, and I am extremely grateful to organizer for having given me a platform, having given me freedom to speak at a time when those who are talking of freedom of speech completely deprived me of freedom of speech. So this is something that we need to point out. Now, but if you adopt the same policies, fiscal policies, the same legal policies, as for example Mr. Chidambaram or Mr. Kapil Sibal, it's very hard to speak of these things. So you have to alter your policies fundamentally. For example, fiscal policies, you have to alter in such a way that you have lower taxes and lighter compliance. Why is it that we have such a low tax base? Because once you get into the tax base, any income tax officer has got carte blanche to harass you and hound you if he or she wants. Fortunately, most of them are decent people, they don't do that. But there are a handful who are not and who can't do it. So people get scared to declare themselves as taxpayers. So we need a system in which you have lower taxes and lesser compliance, and that will give you more return. That will give you more. But if you keep arguing that, look, we have this huge budget deficit, we need to find taxes, so we have to find sectors, we have to tax them. Now, I know how government goes in for the budget. How do they go in for the budget? I know many officials are friends of mine. They have a certain expenditure. Let's say an expenditure on OROP or expenditure on, let us say, pensions or salaries. They will look at the sectors of the economy that generate revenue and say, how much tax do we need to collect to generate that revenue? Now, that is 1 year's budget. But if we look at it from the point of view of 3 years or 5 years or even 7 years, and say at the end of the fourth or fifth or sixth or seventh year, you're going to be generating 5 or 10 times the revenue that you would have generated under this very short-sighted policy of 1 year, 1 year at a time. That would be a better policy to follow, because a policy which, in my view, a sensible fiscal policy is a policy that should be in operation for 3, 5 or 7 years and not just 1 year. The British did it for 1 year. There's no reason why we should do it for 1 year. There's no reason why we should follow the British in some of the awful things they did. I mean, there's no reason at all. So why I'm trying to tell you all this is, you know, and I mean, I'm a little dismayed to see I predicted Mr. Narendra Modi would get 300 seats months before he got it, several months before he got it. I'm very worried. I predicted what happened in Delhi. I predicted what happened in Bihar. I'm not very optimistic at all about UP, quite the worst. Now, I'm also now getting more and more nervous about 2019. And I would like to say, I am an individual who firmly believes we need Narendra Modi as the Prime Minister for 10 years at least, if not more. 2019, he should come back as the Prime Minister, and even 2024, for a year or two, he should be the Prime Minister. I firmly believe that. But the question is, how is he going to come? And today I can tell you, the trajectory that we are following is not the trajectory in which my expectation, my hope, my wish is likely to come true. And this is the reality. Now here is where, for example, the question of national security comes in. So, as I said, we have a people in this country who are patriotic, who are nationalistic, but they have to be addressed in a proper evening. Now, you know, for example, this whole question of social fragmentation, this whole concept that Indian culture is a culture of a particular caste. I mean, in the first place, I believe that, you know, all of us were born in a particular caste, and we, through our duties, through our work, we acquire a caste after birth. I firmly believe that. I don't believe that we can be born to a caste. We are born and we acquire the caste as a result of work. And I think the more that kind of consciousness comes, the better. But the reality of the situation is, Indian culture, once you say it is related to a particular caste, you're basically saying those of other castes should not at all sample this culture, should not at all appreciate this culture, should not at all understand and study this culture. Whereas that is utter nonsense. Now, you know, Professor Gopinath sitting here can give you 100 examples of the fact that in the past, definitely, the great treasures of our culture were treasures that were independent of caste. whether it is in the field of dance, in the field of music, in the field of literature, in the field of the epics, the great treasures have been created by people cutting across all caste barriers. When I say all caste barriers, I mean all caste barriers. But the knowledge of this, the understanding of this, is not seeping in fast enough to counteract the toxicity of the view which has been very widely disseminated from, I mean, I have some theories about that. I don't want to develop that at some length. The toxicity which says, oh, if you know, Bharatanatyam, if you know the vocal music, classical vocal music, if you eat a particular kind of food, if you talk Sanskrit, for example, well, only if you have a sacred thread do you do this. These are all sacred thread. Sanskrit is a sacred thread language. Vegetarianism is a sacred thread diet. The particular dance is a sacred thread language. It's utter nonsense. So my point is very simple. I am saying we are not able to convey that message effectively enough and spread that message effectively enough that this is not a question of a so-called caste. This is a question of a country. And this is a question of everybody in that country as sharers of that country. I want to see, for example, an Ayodhya to Sri Lanka. In Sri Lanka, they have protected some places. I was taken to a place where Sita was rescued. And they told me that with great pride. They showed me two or three locations where Sita was there in Sri Lanka. Nobody in India has told me any such location at all, unfortunately. So I would like to see that kind of a path established. I would like to see so many other things established so that we break the myth that our history was a myth. And this I'd like to see take place in a much faster way. Why I'm coming to all this is, we are living today in an extremely dangerous and complicated time. We are living today in an age of what I may call atomized terror. Now why, for example, the phenomenon of ISIS or Daesh or whatever we call it, is much more dangerous than even the Taliban or even Al-Qaeda, is that Daesh is now an atomized kind of terrorism. It can spread to cities across the world because it is only needs 2, 3, 4, 5 people to have an effective Daesh module that can do, I mean, I'll use the word ISIS because that's more common here. I was in Iran recently giving a talk on Daesh, so I mean ISIS, so I use the word Daesh, but this is not Iran, this is Bangalore, it's not Tehran. So allow me to go back to ISIS. The fact of the matter is that this is a very toxic creed because there is no theology in the creed. Al-Qaeda has got some kind of a theology which is Wahhabi, which is a very concentrated form of Wahhabism. Taliban has got a very confused form of Wahhabism. I have studied the theological books which are read by the Taliban, and Mullah Omar is supposed to be a great theologian. I mean, he has come forward with some of his sayings and all that. I have studied that to the extent that my not very developed intellect understand that. But ISIS has no theology except human cruelty. ISIS is basically basing itself, anchoring itself on the reality that every one of us has a human spirit and an animal spirit. You can call it divine, you can call it human, or you can call it human, you can call it animal. I like to call it human and animal. I don't want to keep using the word divine, because if you keep using the word divine, you are in fact, if I may say so, downgrading the use of a word that should be used very infrequently, because after all it pervades all of us. You don't have to keep using it. You know, you feel the divine. You don't speak the divine. You know, you behave the divine. You know, you don't have to shout the divine, I would say so. So from that point of view, the ISIS theology is very simple. If you have a sex slave, you are a better human being. If you kill 500 people in the most cruel way, chop their necks off, whatever it is, you are the perfection of humanity. You are a most perfect human being, and your path to heaven is strewn with the heads of all these people and the women that you have, whatever it is clear. So this is the same theology I studied the theology of Nazism for a long time. I said, someone who admires the Jewish people. I wanted to understand the pathology of the movement that destroyed so many of the world's most productive people. And I found the pathology is very clear. It liberated us to exercise our most base instincts and to make us feel good for doing so. All of us are base instincts. I am certainly no saint. You know, when I talk to people, when I meet people, when I discuss what they say, I think maybe there are a lot of very saintly people. I'm certainly not a saintly human being. But the fact of the matter is that there are very base situations in us. And once that gets legitimized, once that gets encouraged, it comes to surface. Which is why I'm not surprised that in India, for example, I've long been saying that we have had problems. Like since I've gone to the Middle East, I've seen how many hundreds of Indians there are being indoctrinated into ISIS. And I came back here and said, no, it's not a problem. It really, no, it's something that we have been in denial of ISIS for a long time. Recently, I'm told, under Prime Minister Modi, action has been taken against a lot of ISIS cells across the country. I would say for the last 5 or 6 months, very firm action has been taken against a lot of ISIS cells. I think, you know, we are grateful to the government of Prime Minister Modi for doing that, because this is something that is spreading. My estimate is we have now roughly 80 to 90,000 followers of ISIS in India, which basically means 80 to 90,000 people who believe that what ISIS does in Dhaka, what it does in the Aleppo, in those parts of the world controlled by it, that is what a good human being should do. And they genuinely believe it. But these are people who are scientists. Again, the difference between ISIS and Al-Qaeda and Taliban. Al-Qaeda mostly had foot soldiers. Taliban are entirely foot soldiers. ISIS is almost entirely professionals and so-called individuals. A lot of the cadre program, the reason is, ISIS is using technology to ensure that you can have atomized mass violence. 3 people, 4 people can walk into a shopping mall and kill 500 people. One person can walk into a railway station and kill 150 people. One person. And that one person can operate alone. So this is the virus that is spreading. And this is why I've been long been calling, I think if I may go back and check the things, I think I was the first geopolitical scholar to call for a global coalition against ISIS, which was about 7-8 months later, started getting formed. We are fortunately still a fractured coalition. Russia is on one side, China is out of it, India is largely out of it, except that in terms of intelligence sharing, the Americans are doing it in a very haphazard way. But we have to destroy this cancer before it destroys us. It has not yet reached the stage, it reached the stage of partial metastasization. Means you've got offshoots of things, you know, of these cancer cells spreading across different societies, which can be tackled. But in another 1.5 years or so, my estimate is it will have metastasized to the vital organs in the sense, the major economies of the world, hundreds of towns in the world, thousands of other locations in the world, and at that point in time, to get rid of this cancer is going to take a decade and more of effort, which is going to be extremely enervating for society and for the economy. Again, I'm glad that I think today, if I'm not mistaken, tomorrow we are going to have a Sufi conference in Delhi, in which we are going to be talking in terms of all these various vital. Of course, I have some argument with Sufis. Unfortunately, Sufis have also become a little bit prone towards accepting some of the Wahhabi teachings, and they have been moving away from some of their basic concepts because of belief that some of these concepts are similar, for example, to the concepts of the Bible. That's not such a big problem. The Vedanta. Now the fact is, if you say that you had so many thousands of prophets before the Prophet Muhammad, then we call them prophets, it means the message of all these thousands of prophets is valid. So you have to say, if you are a good believer, you have to say that the Vedanta has also got teaching, which is important. And so if that teaching is reflected in some of the words and teaching, it should not be cast away, as it is being cast away in India. Today, I'm sorry to say, India was once the home of a very moderate faith. Today, because of Wahhabism, extremism is becoming more and more prevalent there, and even among Sufis today, that kind of moderation is now ebbing away. And that is going to create us. Now, you cannot fight this extremism by a different kind of extremism. You cannot fight this intolerance by a different kind of intolerance. You cannot say me and the other, and then say me and the other. You have to have a different kind of message. And in this context, I'd like to say that nationalist communications have been absolutely abysmal. I'll give you a simple example of the Babri Masjid. This was a Shia masjid. There was nobody praying in the masjid. It was destroyed. Terrible. It's really horrifying that the Babri Masjid was destroyed. That should never have happened. But you have about 400 and odd Hindu temples in Kashmir that were also destroyed. Many of them were not disused temples. They were being used daily by worshippers. Why has nobody juxtaposed the two things together? Why has nobody talked about that? People talk in terms of what is happening in Kashmir, some attack on, what about the Kashmiri Pandit exodus? Why is it that we have not been talking about these things? Why is it that we have allowed the debate, for example, in the United States and the Western world to be about selective destruction and not universal destruction? I want to say, as someone who gives a lot of respect, if I may say so, equal respect to the Muslim, to the Hindu, to the Buddhist, to the Christian, to the Sikh, to the Jain, I'd like to say that I believe destruction is bad, universally bad. Which is why I believe what happened in Kashmir is also terrible. But you compare the difference in terms of the echo of what happened in Kashmir. There's no echo at all. There's no echo of what the pundits. There's no echo at all. And if I may say so, I regard that as a great failure of this nationalist community that is so self-satisfied. We have won a great victory on the 16th of May 2014, and we are so self-satisfied, but as yet, this echo is not there, and this echo is essential. Because ultimately, let me tell you, this is 1.26 million people. There are forces from outside the country who are working very intensively to divide us. You had Mr. Malhotra here, who gave a lecture. Of course, Mr. Malhotra, couches his arguments in a certain way, that it may not be received or accepted by a lot of people. We were very honored to carry his essay in the Sunday Guardian. But we also carried an essay by that Jack Fox. As a way of showing, okay, this is the Fox point of view, but Malhotra's arguments were so powerful, they would overpower Fox any day. But I got a lot of nasty kind of response there. Why did you carry Fox on the same page as you carry Malhotra? Look, if you want quote-unquote liberals to read, if you want liberals to read Malhotra, then you've got to have a situation in which you have a perception that you're balanced, and not only a perception, a reality. My point is very simple. If we talk, for example, of religions with each other, Swami Vivekananda. Pardon me for rambling on a little bit, it's going to be very dull and boring to you. Long back, in 2001, I got the Shankaracharya of Kanchi invited to visit China. Now, as a UNESCO professor, I've been visiting China because one of my tracks is India-China. That reason, I visit China quite a lot. I found a deep yearning among many Chinese for spirituality. I found a deep yearning of religious faith among many Chinese. Now, they had a kind of Buddhism, which was there. They had Taoism, which was there. So they had communism, which is, in some respects, a creed. But there was a deep yearning. And I felt that if we bring the Kanchi Shankaracharya to China, and he moves around China, then Sanatan Dharma will also become an option that they consider along with Buddhism and Christianity. Incidentally, Buddhism and Christianity are growing very, very fast in China. Now, China is a country where you've got Sanskrit slogans written in the Chinese language. You've got temples in China which are now considered Buddhist temples. But actually, temples, Hindu temples that are there. So I thought this idea. I persuaded Shankaracharya that he was a wonderful personality. I persuaded him, yes, come. And with great difficulty, I persuaded the Chinese Communist Party officials whom I met to give him the same protocol as the Pope would have got if the Pope were allowed to come to China. Let me remind you, the Pope was not even allowed to come to Hong Kong. If the Pope's aircraft comes on top of Hong Kong, it will be shooed away by Chinese Air Force jets. It will not be allowed to land in Hong Kong. But the Shankaracharya of Kanchi was given, in other words, the same protocol as a head of state. The entire party would be put up in the Zongnan High Guest House. He would be given state privileges. Throughout the visit, he would be treated as a head of state. Now, can you imagine the international media attention of a Hindu priest coming and being treated as a head of state in a communist country? Whether it's CNN, whether it's BBC, whether it's any channel in the world, it would have flocked to China. It would have spread the word of the Shankaracharya's theological teachings through his words, through his speeches across the globe. I thought it was a good idea, quite frankly. I mean, some gentleman in the intelligence agency reported back that this guy is a Chinese agent for asking the Shankaracharya to come. How I was a Chinese agent by asking the Shankaracharya to come and by, you know, insisting that he should get the same privileges as a head of state, something he certainly doesn't get in this country. He's frisked in an airport. I mean, and other people are not frisked. Shankaracharya, unfortunately, is frisked. That's a different point. But what happened? About a week before he was supposed to come, the Chinese had made all the arrangements for him to come. He cancelled it because somebody filed a rent or somebody. There was some purpose. He did not even have to cross the borders. We arranged so that the aircraft, a special aircraft, which we got from donors and all that in India, in South India, would fly overland and reach Beijing and other locations. So he would not even touch 5 minutes of water on the entire flight. Now, I don't want to go into other details, except that he would have his cook around with him. He would have vegetables grown there. So no Chinese vegetables, no Chinese cooking, no Chinese utensils, and certain human functions would be carried out in the garden. I mean, anyway, I'm not going to go into all those details. Suffice it to say that the whole visit was planned in a way in which no practice of the ashram, I don't believe practices, I mean, some practices are there for life, some practices should be eliminated, but I'm a lay person. All this was agreed to. It took 6 to 7 months of effort. Two or three times I had to go there with people from the ashram so that they could convince themselves that, look, yes, all our conditions have been met. All the conditions were met. Ultimately, he decided not to go. So the result, Sanatana Dharma is not an option on the option table in China. You've got Buddhism on the option table, you've got Christianity on the option table, and when I say Christianity is today the fastest growing religion in China, I am afraid against that. Christianity is growing in China, fine. But what I'm saying is, when you've got a great faith like Sanatana, faith in a sense encompasses the wisdom of so many other faiths. Why is it that, you know, we said we are quite happy with having it among a small little group of people, and we are uncomfortable with having it disseminated in a way in which other people would, in a sense, take the first initiations of that. Because after the first initiations, you can go more and more in depth. I mean, it will take a long time, for example, to understand the depth of Professor Gopinath. I wouldn't be able to understand it. So if Professor Gopinath gives me the full, you know, if I may say so, the undiluted, his wisdom, it's going to go over my head. He's got to dilute it severely and serve it to me. And then over time, I'll get less and less diluted versions of it. That's the world, that's humanity. So again, I want to say, quite frankly, this failure is costing us very badly. It may cost us our future. It may, and the future that I see, this is a country of the crossroads. Either we achieve the natural objective of India, which is to be the fulcrum of global civilization. And I say this without any, you know, I'm not any kind of sense of bombast or idealism, based on what limited knowledge I have, the limited study I have, this is a country which can be the global faith. Sanatana Dharma can be the global faith. And my dream is to ensure that Sanatana Dharma becomes the global faith. But for that, I'd like to say, ladies and gentlemen, I think we have to be a lot less self-satisfied. We have to be a lot less self-indulgent. We have to be a lot more critical of ourselves. And we have to understand that so far, I'm sorry to say, our failures have been way more than our successes. Thank you.
I myself have served. After the JNU incident happened, we see a lot of talk about sedition laws being anti-democratic. So what is your take on that?
Who was talking about BC?
Yeah, a lot of, the President of India was petitioned, saying that the sedition laws are colonial, draconian, and also...
I would like to say very clearly that a policeman cannot force any citizen to be patriotic or unpatriotic. Quite the reverse, that if a policeman comes into campus, that policeman will make a lot of people hate the state in a very unjust manner. I have long felt that the sedition laws as presently constituted, they should be effective in cases of terrorism, and in cases of when you are waging war on the state. And they should be ruthlessly applied. For example, if you have got people in Kashmir who are saying, I am Pakistani, the law should be such that they should be immediately put on a plane and sent to Pakistan. Immediately. If you wage war on the state, for example, Haryana, you have a situation in which they burn railway stations. They burn, they kill people. This is sedition. You have a bunch of immature students in JNU talking a lot of rubbish, which I'm sorry, I heard this kind of rubbish in campuses in other parts of the country as well. And in Kashmir, I can tell you, a lot of people speak the same kind of language, and some of those people are in alliance with the BJP. I would like to say very clearly, I have been opposed to the intervention of the police in JNU. I have been opposed to arresting Kanhaiya Kumar. I personally believe that just as the police have made Hardik Patel a hero, the police have made Kanhaiya Kumar a hero. If I were Kanhaiya Kumar, I would be in my prayers every day. I would be thanking the Delhi police and I would be thanking Mr. Commissioner Pasi every day. So the man has become a national hero. And PM, the nationalist community has, we need not rely on the men in khaki. We need not rely on government. Let me tell you one thing, ladies and gentlemen. If you are a chief minister of a state, you have around 40% power. You talk of the total corpus of power in a state. About 40% is there for chief minister. The chief minister's state is, if you've got a majority and a kind of popularity that Narendra Modi has in Gujarat, of course, the country. As prime minister, today, your power is about 15%. You have foreign countries. You have NGOs. You have state governments. You have multiple opposition groups. You have all kinds of other things which basically reduce your power to 15%. There is no way you are going to be able to change the laws or change your administrative practices to go up to even 50%. You accept this 50%, work within this 50%, and I say, in the case of sedition, let us not be in the case of the boy who cried wolf. Wolf, wolf, wolf. So the actual wolf comes, we don't recognize it. Sedition is there in our midst. But it is not foolish enough to declare itself before an audience at JNU. It is not stupid enough to say, I am a sedition, I am working against my country. These are quiet people who are working in our midst. I mean, I hate to say this because it's not politically correct. These are people who ensure, for example, through faulty maintenance, that aviation equipment goes down. These are people who ensure that through faulty equipment, lives get lost. These are the silent people, these are people who ensure that submarines get lost. Let me give you one little tip. We have this great bureaucratic colonial culture. And frankly, I'm not very popular with the bureaucracy at all. Because they don't believe I respect their culture, I respect them, I don't respect their culture. A simple example, let me give you. In some years, 6, 7, 8 of people in the nuclear industry in India and the missile industry were dying. Were being killed. murder, suicide, sudden heart attack, man of 35, 38, heart attack, somebody being hit by a train. He's never walked in that area before. He's never gone near a train track. He's always used a bus or an aircraft. Suddenly he's hit by a train. Some chap comes and kills him by a knife. And in all of these, there is no evidence whatsoever. The police can't find a shred of evidence. They can't find a handkerchief, they can't find an ID card, they can't even find a proper footprint. I researched all that and wrote a piece, first in Sunday Guardian, that look, our scientists are dying at an alarming rate. The reason for that was, I was in the way. I had friends in the scientific community who worried about it, but they were saying government is not taking it seriously. Something is happening, do something. So I wrote that piece. I think I wrote that piece about 3.5-4 years ago. Nobody has died after that. Not one scientist has died whether of hanging, suicide, marital distress, or aircraft crashing on his head, or a train. Not one person. There's every year for that people used to die. Another example, 2011, I wrote about foreign NGOs blocking Kudankudan. And these NGOs were very close to France. And France did not want to spend money on the Russian reactors, because France correctly knows if we buy Russian reactors, we have no money to buy the French reactors. Like, for example, we don't have enough money to buy the French aircraft, quite frankly, and we want to do all the drones and other things that the Indian military and Indian Air Force will do. We frankly don't have that money. So, I wrote that piece. Till that time, it was being ignored. But after that, the government swung into action, and a lot of NGOs were discovered who were doing this. So my point is, the Kanaya Kumar, these are small fry. It's like what I said about soft drugs. It's like I said about little things like alcohol, something so small. We have to aim at the hard core. We have to aim at the real serious threats. We ignore these stupid little silly little threats and we aim at the hard threats. By running after every single threat, we are creating a situation in which the tougher threats, the harder threats, when they come after us, we will not be prepared, we will not be ready, and our systems will be too exhausted to fight.
My second question is closely related to the first one. How does one deal with those who hold lofty ideals of a world without boundaries? Because every time, I mean, this seems to be popular among gullible youth, and then the more they do this, speaking for the nation becomes an act of derision. So how does one deal with it?
See, I would use a different term, not Congress. I would use a term, a world in India without Nehruism, and India without the Nehruvian culture. The Nehruvian culture is the worst attributes of British culture, Mughal culture, and the post-British culture put together is Nehruvian culture. I'm sorry to say, there are many people in all political parties, I'm not going to name those parties because what few friends I have in those parties I don't want to affect, but I've seen multiple people who are totally Nehruvian in all parties, and I've seen them in very high positions in every government. Let me be frank. So I would not use the word Bharat Mukt from Congress. I would use Bharat Mukt from Nehruvian culture. As a practical means, I mean, if you're a politician, prime minister, you can say that, but that's a practical thing for a prime minister or politician. For us, who are not politicians, I think we should use the term Nehruvianism, a word without Nehruvianism in India. Because if you analyze that, what is making the Congress toxic is this Nehruvianism. And of course, I don't want to go too much because the laws in India are so huge. I can be slapped in jail, and all of us can go to jail if I say certain things, but I couldn't therefore hold my fire quite effectively.
Chile, connected to what you just said.
Please, sir.
This now in India seems to be a big mess.
I'm sorry, sir.
The now in the country, both the cases as well as the frustration, there seems to be so many amendments. So is there any effort to somehow streamline this and make it better?
Well, I think the Prime Minister is working on it. I know my old friend Ram Devdani tried to work on it. He came up with something like 12,000 laws that are super close. And Ram is a brilliant lawyer. I'm really sorry to see this, that he and the BJP have drifted far apart. I like Ram a lot. Sometimes some of his causes I don't like, but I like him as a personality. And you know how many laws were finally sought to be removed after Mr. Jethmalani pointed out 12,000? About 11. 11 out of 12,000 were removed, not more than that. Today, a lot of laws, the Prime Minister is trying to remove laws. Most of the laws removed are laws that have never been applied for the last 40, 50, 60 years, which can never be applied. If, for example, there are laws in India which say if you send a letter to a courier, you will be sent to jail. There's a law in India which says, in Delhi, if I remember, that if you have a six-pack of beer, you take six bottles of beer with you, you can be sent to jail. You can only take two bottles. Indians are not trusted to drink more than two bottles. If the British saw you with more than third bottles, they would confiscate all three bottles and have a good time and eat. But that law is still here. So I want to see laws that are fundamentally anti-Indian, because I regard Indian culture as based on the individual. I regard Indian culture as being based on respect for the individual. And we have grown big in those eras where the Raja was not really very interfering. The Raja was like the British monarch. Reign but not really control. Reign, rule but not control. We need a system of reigning, ruling but not control. There's colonial law, there's no real rule. There's no real reign, but there's only control. So I want to see much faster action on the part of Prime Minister Modi, whom I admire a lot, whom I've supported for a long time, whom I still support. I remind you, I want him to come to power, remain in power for more than 10 years. I want to see him play a much more active role in cleansing us of these colonial laws. I'll give you a simple example. There are the laws are such that, you know, now I want this will go on YouTube. Some little statement or word here will be enough, I can assure you, for somebody to file a FIR against us and for all of us to next meet in some court in, you know, in Assam or Bengal or some lovely location where we got Mamata Banerjee or Mr. Gogoi or some very, you know, friendly chap who has got a great, you know, high patriotic impulses. So this is the law. And look, we have been constrained because of that. You know, you're talking of India becoming an IT superpower. How do you have a Google and a Hotmail when you're scared of writing two sentences and the police are going to search your internet and they can send you to jail on some thing, on some excuse? They can do that. So how do you do that?
Basically, this is in addition to the corpus of law, which is somewhat not defensive, there's also new laws being put in place. For example, in the case of Kodi case, basically you ignored that Anglo-Saxon principle. Normally that in the case of the CST Act, for example, you might exercise some legal exercise, all kinds of things are coming in. So in addition to that past, they are also enacting newer laws which are questioning the sensitivities. How is that to be handled?
You know, I would like to see laws, budgets, everything prepared by politicians, and after a fair and transparent process of public inquiry. Now, whatever the draft of the law, it should be brought before the public. It should be streamed online. And after questions and answers, everything are given, after that the law should be tweaked, modified, and then introduced. Now we have a system in which three or four bureaucrats make every law. Now, one of the changes was basically net neutrality. I'm happy to say Sunday Guardian was the first paper which, under Anupam Sarraf, wrote a very strong piece defending net neutrality long back. We were very, and the government of India fortunately accepted that and retained it. But I would like to see, quite frankly, more transparency in our system. I'd like to see every court proceeding streamed on the internet. I'd like to see every committee of inquiry on the internet. Why not? Why should it be under closed doors? What is there to hide? I'd like to see it streamed live. And may I point out a great danger in this country? We're talking about national security. You know, you have, for example, certain types of email providers which are encrypted. and which cannot be accessed, and which are used by money launderers, which are used by terrorists, which are used by people to break the law. Now, I have Gmail, this thing, that thing, I mean, I know that anybody who wants can break into my mail. Anybody who wants can break into my mobile phone, but I'm not bothered, because I'm not doing anything illegal. You're most welcome to break into my mail. The most you find out that I'm not 100% sane. You're most welcome to find out. I'm happy to admit that to you openly. I'm not 100% sane. But I've not seen anybody else who's 100% sane, although many claim to be. But these are a danger to the country. And I think in my view, we should pass legislation that such kind of email service, whether it's based in Switzerland or other locations, should not be allowed to be used by our citizens. Or those servers should ensure that access is given to law-abiding agencies. Now, this entire controversy between Apple and the US government, my take is the whole thing is a Kathakali show. It is a drama. It's a farce between Apple and the US government to show worldwide Apple is fighting for privacy. Because after Snowden revelation, everybody knows there's no privacy on the net. I mean, almost every provider, but certainly US provider. Now, Apple needs to sell its smartphone. It's getting problems from Samsung. The Chinese are coming up. We unfortunately have not come up yet, but hopefully Make in India will come up. So Apple wants to prove to the world that it is safe. The US government wants to prove that Apple is safe. So in my view, this whole thing is a drama. It is not real. This, government battling Apple, Apple battling government. Look, I know the United States. I mean, this doesn't happen, frankly. And so the fact is, the United States government, after 9/11, forced access to almost any data anywhere in the world. These so-called encrypted pages that our governments cannot access can easily be accessed by Americans under the excuse of the war on terror. So what will a good American do? Just two examples I'm giving you. One, let's say there's a political leader in the country, an important political leader. They want to access his any encrypted emails or his whatever, any bank account he's got. They will simply, cough up some kind of a postcard. Professor Gopinath and myself may be asked to send a postcard. So and so is a terrorist. I heard him whispering, terror, terror to somebody. Now, using that, they will force Switzerland and all the other havens to release all the bank data of this person if he's got any bank. Fortunately, in our case, we have a prime minister who doesn't have any money abroad or doesn't have much money in India. So we are reasonably safe, thank God for that. But many other leaders in our country have multiple accounts abroad. And all these leaders are therefore know that the American Uncle Sam knows exactly where their money is. The Chinese are doing a very smart thing. They are making Hong Kong and Macau very safe locations for money to be stored. So the result is, if you store your money there, only the Chinese Communist Party knows what it is. So you better not go very far against the Chinese Communist Party. Otherwise, you might find a leak to the press about your illegal bank accounts. So this is the kind of control they have. And this Americans have done. Two, business. Now, in our country, I've seen, go to even the top leaders, offices, it's Korean, internet screens, your laptops, and your desktops and all, they're not even Indian. So forget that. All key officers routinely use Gmail to each other. Hey, there's a secret. Our business magnates use Gmail, and a very badly encrypted business mail, they have some business mails with very low encryption. So let's say, for example, why my suspicion was raised was that I was trying very hard for a Taiwan-India oil partnership. Because India doesn't have that much money as Taiwan has. We have diplomatic effort. Taiwanese have diplomatic effort. A lot of money but no diplomatic. Come together, we can outbid the Chinese anyway. I tried, but the Chinese group in Taiwan, I think, plus some small problems in the bureaucracy here, I could not succeed. I could not have this India-Taiwan oil and gas thing. But why I was, because I found in a large number of auctions, the Chinese won the bid with a very small margin of increase over the Indian bid. Now, this is unusual. They won practically all the auctions. Any auction they were serious about, they won. Some useless means which subsequently proved to be double useless, they very magnanimously lost. But every other field they won, and they won usually by very small, 1%, 2%, 0.5%, maybe 4% or something, that's all. So my feeling was the Chinese are doing this, certainly the Americans are doing it. So the Chinese, what they do is copy the Americans. The Americans do it first and the Chinese do it afterwards. So what I'm seeing with China, was certainly the American, it basically means that American and companies and other countries that they share the data have got a huge edge over Indian companies. So you may have Make in India, you can't have made by Indian companies, because the essential corporate data are completely public to those countries where competitors are based. Apart from the fact that their rates of tax are lower, their interest rates are lower, it's completely public. So what I'm saying all this is the entire concept of national security. We, in a country where 12, 13 million youngsters demand a job every year, they're not going to get national security unless provided with jobs. Hardik Patel applied, I think, about 27 times for jobs in this Monster and Naukri and all these other job sites. You know, I'm too old now to go to the job sites, so I really don't know more of them. But I'm told Mr. Patel was a very diligent person who applied to all these job sites, and unfortunately, for whatever reason, he could not get a job anywhere. So he decided politics and the agitation of reservation is the way for him. And the Gujarat police made him a deal. Now you have got 13 million potential Hardik Patels coming out of the country. Why are these caste agitations becoming so strong? Why is this, the Jat reservation agitation became so? Because the foot soldiers are unemployed youngsters. Underemployed, unemployed youngsters. So unless you can generate 11-12% of economic growth, unless you can really generate jobs, you are in trouble. As I told you, you can't generate non-industry jobs unless you've got a reasonable freedom of speech, unless you've got civilized laws. And you can't generate manufacturing laws unless these issues, like for example, foreign countries able to hack into your data and steal it. And most of the companies, I've told the experts abroad, that most of the companies that, you know, the company emails are completely easy in this NewsX, for example, there's a company email, and all company people, I don't use that email. So I told the proprietors, I know very well this email, you know, what my Gmail may take 2 seconds, yours will take 5 seconds. It's an extra 3 seconds of safety that I have. It's not worth it. I'm not going to change my email for that, 3 seconds. But that is the problem. And now I'll end with a little story of mine, one of my articles, your question. On 3rd of October 2008, in something called UPI.com, I wrote a column which I sent on the 1st of October. I wrote a, it came on 3rd of October, that the ISI was responsible for 26/11. Their Navy trained our Navy. Their commandos trained these guys. Serving commandos trained these guys. I was given this information, unfortunately, I was in Taiwan at that time. Not by the intelligence agencies of our country, but by people associated with counterterrorism in a small country. I'm not going to name that country. But that country found out almost immediately who were responsible. Our chaps, even 6 months later, were denying ISI had anything to do with it. I remember Mr. Chidambaram saying, not ISI. No, it can't be, it may not be ISI. So, this is the distance between our efficiency and the efficiency of other countries that are fighting a war which in our side is as sharp, as, you know, potentially fatal to us as it is in these smaller countries. So I'm just giving you this one example. On the ISI matter, the ISI was given a clean chip by the government for months after 2016, and more importantly, the Indians who helped the Pakistanis have till today not been questioned. There were 3-4 networks, local domestic networks, who assisted the 26/11 people, who assisted the ISI, no, absolutely no action was taken against any of them. So this is our system, and this is our security. Sorry.
recently came across this blog post, and it was not reported in media. So along with this public burning of public property in Haryana, there were several instances of women who were coming to New Delhi in rape, and it was only reported by Tribune and I think Deccan Chronicle. So we see that in terms of violence, as you mentioned, the base instinct. So we revert back to our base instinct that we do certain kind of act. So, I mean, aside from this state and all, what do you think is the mechanism to build the basic character of its citizens? They don't do such activities. Like, you cannot implement law in certain states.
Look, law is implemented through the police. It's a wonderful force. But not every policeman is honest. Not every policeman has the noble instinct that you are telling me. In Haryana, something very terrible happened. The Delhi water supply system was sabotaged. Now these are planned acts of sabotage. And tomorrow, if you've got a caste agitation across the country, and there are plans in certain quarters of the, to have a breakdown of railway, a breakdown of bus, a breakdown of truck, a breakdown of banking, breakdown of insurance services. And if water supplies are also broken down by mass appeal to caste sentiment, because millions of people are completely unemployed. I mean, you know, what have we done in Haryana? We don't send anybody to jail. I said, Kanaya Kumar got to jail because two of them got jail. They didn't disturb the water supply of Delhi. I'm not saying that what they did is right. I'm saying have a sense of proportion and act according to that sense of proportion. This was to me sedition. This break, the water supply of Delhi thing, and what happened? I was told, frankly, I met people in the army, I met people in the police. The policeman told me secretly that, look, we were ordered not to shoot, we were ordered not to use tear gas, we were even ordered not to use lathis. The army guys told me we were ordered not to shoot. Now, if you send the army, you are sending them to shoot. Soldiers are not trained to bake cakes and jelly and halwa and, you know, and sandwiches. They are trained to shoot. How are you sending soldiers and telling them not to shoot? If this is true, if some authorities told soldiers not to shoot and policemen not even to use tear gas or lathi, what happened? I have seen multiple riots in this country. I am a journalist, I have covered riots. 3 or 4 times I have been slashed at. I have had 2 bullets in my recumbent bag because of once by the riot, there was in the riot. When I was slashed by a riot, I came a bit too close. Look, what happened? In Kashmir, I've seen this multiple times. I'm very interested in Kashmir. I go there often now. The police have been told, were told in Kashmir multiple times.